Friends, welcome to worship on Palm Sunday, and we start with the exuberance of Palm Sunday in a celebratory organ prelude from our own Pat Fitzsimmons. Amen to that. Thank you so much, Pat. Grace to you in peace and welcome to worship here at Edgewood Presbyterian Church online on Palm Sunday, the day when we remember Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, the beginning of Holy Week, and all that is to follow. I hope some of you were able to pick up or have delivered to you palms from the church. If not, if you don't have palms, first of all, you can come get some. We've still got some later. You can get them after worship. We'll leave them out today just in front of the church under the bell. But if you are at home and you've got a plant, if you've got some greens, if you've got some grass, you can wave it on the screen. We are, of course, a very nerdy church, so at the very least, you have the palms of your hands that you can wave at any point during the service, particularly during our first two hymns and during the scripture reading from the Gospel of Mark that we'll read later on. Three quick worship notes. They're the same every week. One, this service is being recorded and will be posted on YouTube later today. So if your camera is on, you may be on YouTube. You too can be a YouTube star. You can put your prayer requests in the chat feature here on Zoom, and Marilyn Jackson, our Deacon of the Month, will share those with us later in the service. And that we are celebrating communion as we do each Lord's Day. We celebrate the Lord's Supper, so find some bread or something to break and find a cup to bless and share together after the sermon during the service. Now invite our liturgist for the month of March, Rick Frenay, to lead us in the call to worship.
From water to wilderness.
God's covenant persists. God's vision comes near.
On stone and in hearts.
God's covenant persists. God's vision comes near.
From the ancestor of nations to the Son lifted up.
God's covenant persists. God's vision comes near.
Give thanks to the Lord who is good.
Whose steadfast love endures forever.
Blessed is the name of the Lord.
Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Let us pray. We praise you, O God, for your redemption of the world through Jesus Christ, who entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph and was proclaimed Messiah and King by those who spread garments and branches along his way. Let these branches be signs of his victory and grant that we who carry them may follow him in the way of the cross, that dying and rising with him, we may enter into your kingdom through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen. Thank you, Rick. Our first hymn is a Palm Sunday hymn that we have not sung before. It's lively and new to us, and I hope you will enjoy it. The hymn is hymn number 199, Filled with Excitement.
All the happy throng spread cloaks and branches on the city streets. There in the distance they begin to see. There on a donkey comes the Savior Christ. Roll and make honor, a thousand voices sing. A praise to the one who comes in the name of God. Our acclamation brings forth in shouts of praise. A triumphant song of joy.
The Apostle Paul writes, in the name of Christ, I urge you, be reconciled to God. Trusting in God's grace, let us confess our brokenness together through this song that we've been singing throughout the season of Lent.
Free us from
Friends, listen so that you may live. The steadfast love of the Lord never fails. Believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and restored to new life. It is now time for our sermon from the steps, and Lily Kane is up, so I'm going to unshare my screen and let her take over. Take it away, Lily.
Good morning, everyone. I hope everyone's doing well today. I'm screen sharing not as much as I normally do, so pardon me if I'm a little out of my normal routine. But good morning, friends, and happy Palm Sunday. And a typical word we use to greet one another during Palm Sunday is Hosanna. Can y'all say that with me?
Hosanna.
Yay. Cool. Today we're celebrating Palm Sunday. And I bet a lot of folks have their palm branches, leaves. Sorry, I always get the branch for the versus the leaf mixed up. I know I'm not really that smart, but it's exciting. So if you don't have one, it's also okay. These are just a cool symbol. So if you don't have one, no worries. So it's almost Easter, which is exciting, but we're not quite there. Today we're celebrating when Jesus returned to Jerusalem, which was his hometown where he was born. I want us to take a second to think about our homes. My home is a great place. I have things to eat there and like a cozy space when I need to sit and think. When it's safe, sometimes I have people come to my house, not anytime recently, but you know what I'm saying. But it's a safe place and it's where I feel comfortable and where I can feel like I can be me. But why do we use palm branches to celebrate Jesus coming home? We celebrate that as Palm Sunday to remember Jesus came to Jerusalem and everyone was glad to see him. They waved palm branches as he entered. But why did they wave palm branches? It's kind of, I always wondered that. That was a weird thing for, I mean, and I've been to parades before in America, but they've never waved palm branches. They've like thrown things like candy, right? But not palm branches. So what happened was where Jesus lived, there were lots of deserts, which are dry and hot, sandy places. Back when Jesus was alive, a lot of folks had to travel these deserts and walk. They couldn't drive cars like we do. They had to walk for a really long time. And they would search for these places called oases or a big lake where they could rest, drink water, and cool off. Well, while these folks were journeying and looking between their places for these oases, the way they would find an oasis is they would see a big palm branch. Now this is where I'm going to share my stuff. Hold on. Oh, there we go. So we have a palm leaf, which is cool. This is what a palm branch looks like. Those are a few palm branches. So we have a piece from that, which is cool. So they would look for a big palm branch or big palm branches waving in the wind to show them that they could come get water and rest. Now, because they knew to look for these palm branches and palm leaves, these folks who lived in the deserts came to see a palm branch as welcome, as safety, as rest. And so this became a big symbol for them. And that's why they waved palm branches and palm leaves when Jesus came, because they were welcoming him home. They were saying, "You're home, you're safe, you are welcome here." So the people welcomed Jesus into Jerusalem using these cool palm branches to let him know that he was safe and loved. He also rode in on a donkey instead of a large horse. That made a statement to the folks who lived there because they were really glad to see him and they were celebrating him in this big parade. And I think they sort of expected him to ride in on a really big horse that maybe looks like this. Sorry if my screen is blocking. Or maybe like this. I don't really know what color horses live in various places, but instead he rode on this donkey. And I'm kind of an animal lover, so I kind of think he's cute, but I would understand maybe the safety in riding a big horse over this cute little guy. But anyway, he rode on a donkey to make a statement. He wanted to show the folks in Jerusalem, I am not this big rich dude with lots of big horses, with lots of power. I'm wanting to help you. And the folks who were in Jerusalem knew he wanted to help them. But I think they wanted help in a different way. I think they were expecting him to help their government, the people who ran their town, become more fair. And while that would have been a really cool thing to do too, Jesus was actually there for a much bigger purpose. He was there to show everyone God's love, and that God's love is more important and stronger than governments, rich folks, and big horses. And in fact, I think we all here know that the end of Holy Week, things were not very safe for Jesus, and he was not very welcome. And Jesus knew that going into all of this celebration. He knew at the end that he was not going to be safe and welcome. But he also knew that he was going to show folks that God is our home and God is our safety. Now, here today, we at this congregation don't live in the desert, but we still use these palm branches to remember Jesus's parade and to remind us that here Jesus came in his cute but really small donkey. And he wanted to remind the folks of Jerusalem that God's love isn't about our stuff, our governments. It's about our safety and our love. So now we are going, I'm going to stop sharing. And now I want everyone to get their piece of paper and writing utensil. If you're using the same piece of paper that you were using when we started this, I'm really proud of you because we are two different people. But just get a piece of paper. It doesn't matter what it is. And my question for you today is, where do you feel safe? It can be one place. It can be several places. Just think about where you feel safe.
I feel safe at my house. Or at home.
Now, I'll let that little seed develop however you'd like it to, but let's go ahead and pray. Dear Lord.
Dear Lord.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For safe spaces.
For safe spaces.
For home.
For home.
And for always welcoming us.
And for always welcoming us.
Help us.
Help us.
Help us.
To share your safety.
To share your safety.
And love.
Love.
And love.
With others.
With others.
Amen.
Thank you, Lily. Excellent. All right. And I'm going to ask everyone to remute themselves, except for Rick Frenay, who's going to join us now and offer the prayer for illumination and the psalm.
Let us pray. Eternal God, whose word silences the shouts of the mighty, quiet within us every voice but your own. Speak to us through the suffering and death of Jesus Christ, that by the power of your Holy Spirit, we may receive grace to show Christ's love in lives given to your service. Amen. Psalm 118 contains a number of verses that have been used throughout the centuries in both Jewish and Christian worship. It is a liturgical song of victory and thanksgiving. Please join me now in the responsive reading. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for God is good.
God's steadfast love endures forever.
Let Israel say,
God's steadfast love endures forever.
Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord.
This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it.
I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation.
The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
We bless you from the house of the Lord.
The Lord is God and has given us light.
Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar.
You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God. I will lift you up high.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for God is good.
For God's steadfast love endures forever.
Holy wisdom, holy word.
Thanks be to God. Well, no surprise at what our gospel lesson is this morning. It comes to us from chapter 11 of the gospel according to Mark. We were in chapter 11 a few weeks ago when we heard what comes right after this, which is the incident in the temple. We'll talk more about that in a second. But listen now for God's word to us from Mark chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethpage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. This is the gospel of Christ for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Friends, having heard that story, it's time to sing the official Presbyterian Palm Sunday hymn, hymn 196, "All Glory, Laud, and Honor."
Before thee we present.
Feels like Palm Sunday. Y'all, we know this story so well. It's a memory-making story if you grew up in the church. It's not Hosanna Sunday or Jerusalem Sunday or even Donkey Sunday. It's Palm Sunday, named for the branches waved and laid down on the path, the branches that we've been waving this morning. And it's one of the few moments when we Presbyterians who spend so much time in our heads, when we get to worship in a tactile way, we get to touch something. We get to have a hands-on moment of praise, a physical sensation of divine reality and royalty. It's all glory, laud, and honor, and it's blessed is the one, and it's taking these long strips of palm branches. Maybe you did this when you were a kid, and bending them into crosses or flowers and letting them dry out. I love Palm Sunday. There's been a movement to minimize Palm Sunday and combine or even replace it with a Passion Sunday. And some churches are doing that, and I think it's okay. Some churches are telling the story of the crucifixion this morning. That's the scripture they're reading. The thought behind that is that most churchgoers are going to skip Thursday and Friday of this week, because that is just too much church. And if you skip Thursday and Friday, or maybe this is why you would skip Thursday or Friday, but if you skip Thursday and Friday, you miss out on the betrayal and the disciples who can't stay awake and the arrest and the mocking and the violence and the cross. You miss out on Jesus crying out, breathing his last, giving up the ghost. If you skip Thursday and Friday, you get to go from this joyous parade to the resurrection without having to enter the valley of the shadow of death. But I know you, and you know that valley. And I trust that many of you will join us for at least some of the worship on Thursday and Friday, and our special Saturday event that I'm going to tell you about in a few minutes. And if you can't be with us, with your church community, I hope you'll be aware of the significance of these days and find a moment for prayer or the reading of Scripture. As we said on Ash Wednesday this year, death has been in the air, literally in the air, since before last Holy Week. And our tradition does not shy away from death, but instead has so much to say about it, so much to offer to a world that can barely say death's name. The world offers euphemisms and pleasantries in place of truth. Out there, they whisper when relationships or dreams die. But in the Jesus tradition, we name the losses and we point to how they're shaped like crosses. And we make space for grief in order to make room for hope. Out there, they tiptoe around death, hoping to sneak by it. In the Jesus tradition, we know death's inevitability, and so we meet it in broad daylight at noon, and we face it with our team of beloveds beside us. We're trembling still, but we are bold in our resolve and our confidence and our curiosity. We need truth. We could never say Jesus passed on the cross. We could never say Jesus knew he was going to Jerusalem to transition to the next life at the hands of the empire and the religious leaders. No, we say he died on the cross. Our tradition demands that we look around at everything and see what is truly going on. Looking around and seeing what is going on is exactly what Jesus does after this Palm Sunday parade at the end of that reading. Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. What does Jesus see? What does he see when he has finally arrived in Jerusalem and he stands in the temple and he looks around at everything? Well, he sees the chaos of a holy city busting at the seams with pilgrims from all over in town for Passover. The holiest place in a land occupied by the Romans. The holiest place is filled with all sorts of extra people who are there for a festival that tells the story of God raising up Moses to stand up to the oppressive empire, raising up Moses to lead the people to freedom, to liberate them from Pharaoh's grasp, in order to lead them to this very land that is under the thumb of Rome. Well, that's quite a thing to be celebrating with a whole bunch of people in a city. And that is why noted feckless thug Pontius Pilate is in town. That's why he had to leave his seaside resort to come babysit Jerusalem for a week, to ensure that this troublesome people stayed in line, that nobody got a messiah complex and tried to start a revolution. That these different sects of Judaism didn't start squabbling, to be sure that nobody started or tried anything. The very next day after this parade, Jesus will enter the temple again and he will drive out the sellers and turn the tables of the money changers. Jesus stands in the temple and looks around at everything. Some religious leaders have been after Jesus for a while, but we are told repeatedly that they feared the crowds. And even this week, they will at first decide not to move, that arresting Jesus during the Passover might cause a riot. Jesus stands in the temple and looks around at everything. But those leaders will come to the realization that if they make their move at night, if they do it in the shadows, if they do it quickly and quietly, that all this chaos Well, it could be fantastic cover for their dastardly deed. In the chaos of the city, they can grab him after the meal, when the city is sated and unbuckling its belt and turning on the football game and snoozing on the couch. And they can rush things along and get the Romans to have him on a cross by breakfast. All nice and legal. When the Romans informed you that you were now part of their empire, they took away your ability to dispose of your own problems. Any state-sanctioned death penalty murders would be carried out by them. Thank you very much. So the religious leaders would have some goons grab this heretic Jesus in the night, and then they would take their chance to interrogate and to dehumanize him. Jesus stands in the temple and looks around at everything. In the courtyard of the temple, Peter will deny him three times. The leaders will do all this while much of the city sleeps off the wine. And at the first sign of daybreak, they will hand Jesus over to the Romans. And they will let the Romans do what Romans do. Beat him, dehumanize him further, and then crucify him before the Today Show is over. Jesus stands in the temple and looks around at everything. He had told the disciples what would happen and that it would happen in Jerusalem. He knew that he has been far too disruptive to the powerful. With his unwillingness to turn down the volume of God's love. And so he arrives in this city with his eyes wide open. This is no accidental parade. His triumphal entry has all these kingly markers, the cloaks and the palms and the shouting and the invocation of the name of King David. And Hosanna. Hosanna was a Jewish liturgical word. It's a mashup of some words from the psalm that we read earlier. Rick read the line, "Save us, we beseech you, O Lord." If you manipulate those words, you get Hosanna. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. It's a worship word with a deep meaning stretching back through the tradition. Save us, please save us. We are begging. This crowd identifies Jesus as the one, the Messiah, the anointed one, the one who will save them, the king, the one who will provide liberation and overthrow their opponents. Hosanna. Life is hard. Save us. The Romans are oppressing us. Save us. You'll show them who is boss. Save us. We will follow you to victory. Save us. Slay the giant, son of David, and save us. Kill them and save us. But the prophet Zechariah writes, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he. Humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Jesus leans into that image of a very different kind of king arriving in the city, not to conquer, but to restore. That is confusing. This wild scene is perplexing. It's a ruckus. It's provocative. It's setting the stage for the rest of the drama of the week. It is a declaration that there is more going on here than Caesar or Pilate or the religious leaders or the crowds or even the disciples can see. For Jesus has come not with military might, but with a holy peace and with forgiveness and with Hosanna salvation. But it all looks so different from how we would do it. He can see what we cannot. It's such an odd request to go procure this baby donkey from the village. But they do it. These disciples, who will very soon not do very well at what Jesus asks them to do, they do it. And apparently the Lord needs it is good enough for them. And it's good enough for the villagers. Imagine if we were asked, why are you doing this? About any of the things that we do. And imagine if we could truly answer, well, the Lord needs me to do this. This parade starts a week of contradictions that somehow make perfect sense to the one with eyes to see, which is emphatically not any of us. And so in that vein, I want our final Lenten question for our sheets of paper. I want that question to be intentionally ambiguous. We're not going to define the terms. We're not going to clarify the question I'm about to ask you. I want y'all to trust yourselves to interpret this question in the way that makes something close to sense for you. I know that might sound frustrating and confusing, but I invite you to look around at everything. And I invite you to answer as honestly as you can. Why are you doing this? I hear the temptation to say, what? What is this? What do you mean? And resist it, resist it. Answer it for yourself. Why are you doing this? Friends, in the gospel, according to John, our Lord says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Let us all now share the peace of Christ with one another. The peace of Christ be with you all. Peace, peace, peace. All right, I'm going to ask, we have Pavlina has an announcement that is kind of urgent and a way for us to help our neighbors. And so, Pav, will you take it away with your announcement? Are you ready?
I am ready. So Pastor Joe was kind enough to go along with this crazy and last minute idea to try to put together Easter baskets for kids of families who've been affected by the tornado in Oak Mountain, Helena, Centerville, and possibly even Calera. I have some contacts that I've been in touch with who are getting me names of families and addresses for us to deliver these baskets on Saturday. And I have put together a list. I don't know if I can share my screen, Joe.
You should be able to.
Okay. Is that, can y'all see that?
Yep.
Okay. So those of you who would like to contribute to this, you can either drop off. Those are the list. There's the list of the items. If you can drop those off by the church by Friday at noon, or you can send Venmo to Judy's Venmo account. It's Judith-Green-8. Any amount, $2, $5, whatever you can do, I will get that by Friday at noon and go by the church, see what items we have been able to collect, and then use the money to buy whatever else we can do to make the baskets. My goal kind of would be to make about 20 baskets if we can. If not, if we make 10, we make 10. That's 10 happy kids that we will hopefully will have happier Easter than what they would have had. My cell phone number is on this screen. So those of you who would think about donating any kind of items, if you could text me what you're planning on getting, that way I can kind of coordinate and make sure we don't end up with only baskets and no eggs. That would be great. So I can just text you back and say, hey, that's great or not or whatever. This will be the easiest way, I think, with it being so last minute instead of sending up like a sign up sheet and that kind of thing. So if you guys can just write down my cell phone number, Judy's Venmo, and we'll just go from there. Thanks, and Joe.
Thank you so much. I will put all this information in the weekly email that goes out tomorrow morning as well. The phone numbers and the Venmo and the list and everything.
Perfect. Thank you.
All right.
Right. I need to stop sharing my screen, right?
Yes, please.
Okay.
A few further announcements. Our Joy class is meeting today after worship to continue their book on the great prayers of the Bible. Fascinating discussions every week when they meet. BYG is meeting today at 4:00. We are moving our site though, so parents pay attention. Do not drive to Southminster Presbyterian. There will be nobody there. Go to Oakmont Chapel Presbyterian Church, which is just a little bit further down the road in Hoover. We'll meet from 4 to 5:30 and have an absolute blast. The first 2 days of this week are pretty normal. We have our, well, they're actually a little different. We're gonna try to do our kids Zoom tomorrow at 4:00. And the last I checked, we might actually be able to pull off the weather on this. So kids Zoom tomorrow at 4:00. I love that we're calling it Zoom, even though we're doing it on the front lawn. In-person kids Zoom. This is what happens when you create new ministries in the midst of a pandemic. So we're going to have fun. We're going to do lessons and time together, share news, share stories. We need kids. We want kids to bring something purple if they can. We will have our dance party, of course. So we'll see you at 4:00 for Kids Zoom. Tuesday, the choir is meeting. Is that right, Amanda? Give me a thumbs up. Okay, good. Choir's meeting on Tuesday. And then I'm gonna show you a slide with the rest of, and talk through what's going on the rest of Holy Week here. We've put this information in several places, but just to walk through it quickly on the week of, on Maundy Thursday, our worship service on Zoom begins at 5:30 p.m. You will definitely need bread and cup. We will celebrate the Lord's Supper. It will last about a half hour, 45 minutes maybe. A moving service as we hear about the Last Supper and move towards towards Gethsemane. That's where we're going on Thursday night. On Friday, we have two events. First, the Homewood Way of the Cross, which was canceled last year, is happening this year. We're asking people to wear masks and be smart, and we're keeping the whole thing outdoors. Normally, this service ends at our church in the sanctuary with Pat on the organ. This year, we're just going to end on the front lawn and then sing a cappella. But the Way of the Cross, if you don't know about it, starts at 2:00 at Homewood Central Park. And it's all the churches of Homewood that are willing to gather a whole bunch of people. And we have a cross that makes its way down Oxmoor Road with several stops along the way for prayer. And the service will conclude on our front lawn. And then also on Good Friday, a worship service at 6 p.m. It'll be relatively short and very simple and solemn, sending us into the rest of the weekend. And that will, of course, also be here on Zoom. Links to all this will be in the emails tomorrow. We're going to use different worship links just to keep things clean. So look out for those links, and they'll also be on our website. And then on Saturday night at 8 p.m., we're doing something a little bit different. An event that I'm calling the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, which is, you might remember, Mark chapter 1, verse 1. We're going to read the entire Gospel of Mark. It should take a little bit under 2 hours. We're going to start at 8 with chapter 1, and we're just going to keep going. We have a whole lineup of volunteers. Volunteers, you'll be getting your scripts later today. A whole lineup of readers who will each have a chapter. There'll be some musical interludes. Obviously, you know, I understand if you can't stay for 2 hours, that's fine. If you can be there for part of it, that's great. But of course, we'll start at the beginning, a very good place to start. And then we'll make our way, and our time together will conclude with the end of the gospel, with the resurrection, and that will send us off to bed with dreams of Easter morning. So I hope you can be there for this. All of this will be in our weekly email, but Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, and then, of course, Sunday morning, we celebrate the resurrection right here at 9:30, usual place and time. Been telling you about a youth retreat coming up. That's April 16th and 17th. I haven't gotten any inquiries on this yet, which means I haven't tested my tent to see if it leaks. So if you have a youth who would like to go to Living River for a retreat on the 17th, they can be there for the day of the 17th, or they can come the night before, and we're going to have a big camp out, and it should be kind of fun trying to keep everything nice and COVID safe. Reminder to mark your calendars. We'll give you more information about this as we get closer, but we are also having a BYG trivia night to raise money for Montreat this summer, which looks like it is going to happen. So please mark your calendars for Friday, April 23rd in the evening. We'll get you more information and start thinking about who you might want to team up with. Also, if you have a business or you know of a business that might want to sponsor help sponsor this trivia night in exchange for some free exchange for some advertising. Talk to me about that as well. And of course, your faithful giving to this congregation has allowed us to thrive in the midst of all this chaos and to continue to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ with our mouths, with our voices, with our hands and our feet. And I give you deepest thanks on behalf of the session for your continued support of the church. Friends, it's time to meet at the table, so please gather your elements, your cup, and your bread as I gather mine. Jesus said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If those who hear my voice open the door, I will come in to them and eat with them, and they with me. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are all who find refuge in God." In this holy week, we gather around the table yet again to hear stories, to share in promises, to break bread together. This meal is not an Edgewood meal. It's not a Presbyterian table. It's Christ's table. Christ is the host of this meal, and you are invited to it. Let us pray. O Lord, our God, creator and ruler of the universe, in your wisdom you made all things and sustained them by your power. You made us in your image, setting us in your world to love and to serve you and to live in peace with your whole creation. From generation to generation, you have guided us, sending prophets to turn us from wayward paths into the way of righteousness. And out of your great love for the world, you sent your only Son among us to redeem us and to be the way to eternal life. As one of us, he knew our joys and sorrows and our struggles with temptation. He was like us in every way except sin. In him, we see what you created us to be. Though blameless, he suffered willingly for our brokenness. Though innocent, he accepted death for the guilty. On the cross, he offered himself a perfect sacrifice for the life of the world. By his suffering and death, he freed us from sin and death. Risen from the grave, he leads us to the joy of new life. Remembering your goodness and grace, O God, we offer ourselves to you with gratitude as we share this joyful feast. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon this bread and cup. Make us one in the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Lead us, O God, in the way of Christ. Give us courage to take up our cross and in full reliance upon your grace to follow him. Help us to love you above all else and to love our neighbors as we love ourselves, demonstrating that love in deed and word in the power of your Spirit. Give us strength to serve you faithfully until the promised day of resurrection, when with the redeemed of all the ages, we will feast with you at your table in glory. through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And now with the boldness of the children of God, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us in whatever language or version means most to you. We pray together saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Beloved, on the night of his betrayal and arrest, our Lord Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks to God, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup, saying, This is the cup of the new covenant, sealed in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of sin. Whenever you drink of it, do this in remembrance of me. Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the saving grace of our Lord until he comes. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Friends, come now to the welcome table. I invite you to break your bread, saying, I recognize Christ in you. And to then raise your cup in a holy toast, saying, My heart is burning for God's people. Amen. Marilyn Jackson is our deacon of the month, and I'll invite her now to share the joys and concerns and prayers that have been collected in the chat.
I am. Okay, there I am. I couldn't find my unmute button. Matt Smith is hiding behind a purple screen that says M. He says, Good morning, everybody. Matt, Nolan, and Cooper are there. Matt was the first one who ran an errand for us when COVID hit a year ago, and all us old folks were afraid to go outside. So thankful prayers up for Matt. From Brooke and Kristen, prayers for the cities of Pelham, Helena, the Oak Mountain area, and all that have been impacted by the tornado on Thursday. And I especially want to say, be with the families of those who have lost loved ones. Emma Richardson says, God bless the Tooth Fairy. And from Nora's heart, Amanda Klimko says, her granddaughter says, I really wish we could be back at church. And don't we all? Don't we all? And looks like that's it.
Thank you, Marilyn. We also, I think word spread pretty quickly this week, but we pray for the family of Mary Hopkins, who died on Tuesday. I've been telling anyone who will listen, you know, her husband Paul died on Christmas Day this past year, and Mary died on what would have been Paul's 100th birthday. And gosh, I can't help but think she had to get to the party. So we hold that whole family in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, you are our guide and our companion. From our beginning to our end, you are there. You run this race alongside us. You encourage us. You comfort us. You tend to our wounds. You carry us when we don't think that we can take another step. For 6 weeks, O God, we have been on a Lenten journey, and you have been right here with us. In our discipline and our devotion, in our weakness and our failure, you've been with us in our fear, You have been with us in our hope. As we spend this final week with Jesus in Jerusalem, we are amazed once again by his gentle spirit and his fierce determination. As he confronts those who challenge him, he confronts our own stubbornness and defiant wills. As he cares even for those who hate him, we are challenged to love as he loves. As he bears witness to the emergence of your kingdom, our eyes are opened to your presence all around us. As he moves with resolve toward the cross, we find ourselves struggling to understand why it has to be this way. Oh God, the journey is not just about the destination, it is about each step along the way. The journey itself is a blessing with all of its joys and sorrows. As we run this race, you are shaping us into new people. As we move with you, we are continually born anew. Help us to be attentive to each step in the shadows and in the light. Help us to fully experience all that we encounter, the good and the bad. For in it all, we discover you. Though the race of life goes on, our Lenten journey is nearing its conclusion. Bind us ever closer to Christ so that we may turn our hearts and minds to all that he experienced in the crucible of this Holy Week, a week both terrible and wonderful. God, our help and strength, you have satisfied our hunger with this Eucharistic Thanksgiving meal. Strengthen our faith today that through the death and resurrection of your Son, we may be led to salvation. For he is Lord, now and forever. Amen. Friends, as we prepare for our final hymn and our charge and benediction, we hear once more from the Gospel of Mark. It was 2 days before the Passover and the festival of unleavened bread. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by stealth and kill him. For they said, not during the festival, or there may be a riot among the people. And now may the steadfast love of God, the abundant grace of Jesus Christ, and the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit be with you all this day and always. And remember the words of the Lord Jesus, if any wish to be my disciples, let them take up the cross and follow me. Thanks be to God.
Amen.